We're excited to love you two times. We like the Doors. But, guys, we're going to keep it going. We're going to keep it going for another powerhouse who just happens to be a delightful person, one of my favorites. She's been on the show for a long time. She's near and dear to our hearts. Please give it up for Miss Rachel! Convention, where it was and when?
My first ever was actually in England.
Oh, wow.
It was in Birmingham, it was in the asylum.
Fancy.
Yeah.
Mine was here, that's why I was asking.
Nice.
And Richard was here too.
So basically all the cool people.
No, I'm saying no, we weren't fancy like you. Like sitting here in England. Mm-hmm. It was like a breeding ground at the time. That was in the early 70s. And here we are. Anyway, have fun, Rach.
Thank you.
Rachel Minor!
Hello, guys! Woo! How are you?
I love you!
And right here, there's a happy birthday, too. Somewhere out. Happy birthday to everyone's birthday. Oh, thank you. Are you guys having a good start? It sounded really fun. It's like, yeah.
I love you!
I love you so much. You guys are freaking, I guess other people are saying other words. Amazing. Serious. I know, I've missed you. Yes! I assume that's a Clarence bracelet? Nice. Okay, so, I'm so excited to get rolling on this. Should I start answering questions? And just know that you are loved and you're amazing and that I just want to spend all my days with you guys. Seriously.
Hi.
Hey, what's up?
So this fits perfectly with the fact that you just showed us such affection. Anybody who follows you on social media knows you're such a bright, shining, sweet, kind, loving human being, and it's really hard in the world right now for a lot of people, and I was wondering if you could share some of the things that you inspire you, remind you why the world is good kind of things.
Well, you guys do. I can't even begin to describe what a miracle you are to me, because I'm not, a lot of people deal with a lot of nastiness on social media, and we don't have that on like the pages that I'm on, and that's because of you guys. We're just like, no, this is gonna be a nice place. Like, we need these little bubbles of just, you know, goodness, and that's all thanks to you. So it's literally, I think it's probably where a lot of people avoid when they want to feel good about themselves, just avoid all social media. But it's the opposite for me, because I get to connect and speak with you guys, and you encourage me and lift me up all the time. So thank you all. And on that note, I guess what inspires me, because I don't ever want to, I really, really don't, I think it's important. As important as it is to spread kindness and hope and all that, I think it's super important never to do that falsely, because it undermines it and it ruins it. So I'm not just like, oh, now I'm gonna go post my sunshines and, you know, hearts or whatever it is. It's like, no, I think you have to feel it fully every time, or don't say it at all. And what gets me through and what inspires me is I look at the world and there is so much that's so dire, and there's so many things going through, so many people going through things that are so horrific. And I think about the generations that are being raised having confronted so much trauma and pain, where, just for example, they fled their countries that were violent, and violence was all they knew, and then they were thrown into refugee camps or detention centers, and no one took care of them. They're separated from families and all these things, and that's the trauma that is just reality for so many people. And so I really do think every day about what kind of world we're going to create and how important it is that we create something that is hopeful, that gives people a chance to turn things around. And I know if we're just all mired in, as much as there is to get angry about, if we're just all mired into sadness and anger, we'll never be able to turn things around. So that's basically what keeps me going. Does that?
That was a wonderful answer. Thank you. And thank you.
Thank you so much. Seriously.
Hi.
Hey.
You give wonderful speeches, by the way. I love them every time.
Thank you.
My question is, if you had complete freedom to create any supernatural rule that had to be followed on the show, like how to kill a certain demon or something like that, what would you create?
Wait, create a, like a rule?
You yeah, said like decapitation kills vampires, do that kind of, you know?
yeah, I don't know. I'm like trying to think of a very, like a Rachel one, not so much a Babe one. Like I was thinking like, anytime you hug someone, they become better people. I can heal all their trauma and anger. Like imagine if we could do that with all the politicians around. Like that'd be awesome. I just wonder. Yeah, and like, what about all the, like, because I mean, one of the things I love about Supernatural is that a lot of the characters, even when they're evil, there's still some good in them. There's still a bit of everything. We kind of, even, and the good characters are a little bit bad. We all live in the gray. So I think it'd be wonderful to have some kind of way that you could actually heal that bad part so that there was nothing but good left. So that we didn't have to chop their heads off. Just a thought. That was a very silly Rachel answer, but you got it. Yes.
Hi, I'm Love from Australia. Welcome.
That was a long trip.
Yeah, it was.
Love
you. So I wanted to ask you, as much as like I love your character, if you could be any other character, who would you be on the show?
That's a really good question. My problem is, if I was going to be that character, I'd have to like fully be the embodiment of that character, so the other actor playing the character, because I wouldn't want to change. I love the people who play these characters so much. I think it would be Cass, honestly. Amazing character on so many levels, and I always feel like I'm trying to learn how to human, and I'm not very good at it, and so he does that in a wonderful way, yeah, for a lot of reasons. What about you?
I feel like I would be Rowena, because she's just so sassy.
Amazing. Ruth is just like, who wouldn't want to be Ruth? She's just like the coolest of the cool.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Love it.
Thank you.
Hey.
Hey.
How are you?
I'm really nervous. I promise not to cry this time. I was just wondering, I know you're really busy with Random Act right now, but are we going to get, or are you ever thinking about working on a future campaign like Be Their Parents again, or, because that would be really cool.
Oh, that's awesome. I love working on that. I have no plans in the works right now, but I'm open to whatever, always. And I love all the people I got to work with on that. So, I like getting to play with you guys, so to speak, like, you know, just the communication back and forth. So I'm lucky enough with Random Acts to get to do that all the time. So it keeps me going. But yeah, I would love to do.
I need more Rachel stuff.
Nice.
Yes.
Awesome. Noted.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So
and I love you. You're wearing a Gish shirt, right?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, thank you. So I was wondering, like, throughout the years, there's been, like, Dean compliments and waitresses here and there, and, like, a Reaper, and, like, when he was Emmanuel. But, like, Cass really, like, only had, like, some real, like, long-term affection for Meg. And there was, like, the pizza man scene. Like, so, like, what was your reaction when they told you, like, you won't make it, but, like, you got an agent on your shoulder. Like, what is the...
Well, I didn't have a heads up. Like, I just read the scripts, and they're awesome. So I was always like, I get to do... This is so cool. And I really am in love with the cast-Meg dynamic. I just love that relationship. So I guess I ship Cass and Meg. So I liked anything they did along on that line.
He was your unicorn.
Yes.
Like, well done with that.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. This is Clarence. So, of course. No. But I just think it for a lot of reasons I like the dynamic of that relationship because it was obviously too. I don't want to say people because they're not people, but to whatever they are, that were drawn to each other for who they were, that despite all the odds, and it was kind of like non-gender specific. It wasn't like your typical relationship in any way. It didn't fit any criteria or mold, but they were very like, especially Meg was very loyal to him and really looked out, and I loved that. I felt like that was a genuine love that was more born out of like amazing admiration than anything else. So, do you have anything to add to that?
I mean, yeah, like I feel like you are the reason that like demons can love or showed us that. So I feel like you did a really good job of that. So well done.
Everyone can love me. I just need some hugs.
Hugs. I want to say first that you're like such a big inspiration.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And then here's my question. So what's Meg's take on what's going on with everything right now? If she was to come back.
One of the things I loved about Meg, she's never phased. So I'm guessing that even with all the craziness that's going on, she's probably taking it in stride. I definitely feel like she'd be like, what's up with the fact that like no one came to rescue me, no one cared, no one ever talked about the fact that I was gone. But in the funny way, you know, I think that in that final scene with Sam in Goodbye Stranger, she said as much, and that was before they like just let her sacrifice herself for them and didn't say or do anything. So yeah, I feel like she'd kind of be sarcastic about all of it, and she definitely had some witty ways of summing it up. What do you think?
I think it would be a good time for her to come back since Cass is kind of alone to piggyback on the last question so she can like help him now.
I like that. I like the idea that she's been somewhere like secretly helping him the whole time because I feel like that's very Meg. Like she didn't need credit. So I like the idea that she's actually somewhere pulling strings and helping him and you know, guiding him regardless. That's my little. That's me. That's my ship.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Hi. Hi.
How are you?
I'm great. I'm seeing you. My question is, so what's been your favorite fan experience so far in all your years of...
My favorite what?
Fan experience.
Oh God, all of them. You guys, just on a daily basis, you make my life better and more full and have... I feel like you give me a feeling that there's a purpose for me in the world. And that what could be more important, just, you know, every one of your stories, it moves me beyond words and makes me feel like what I'm doing is worth something. I think a lot of people, I don't know, I won't even say they don't understand. What I've gotten to see, I hope people can understand, what I've gotten to see is so much goodness, so much capacity for kindness, so much caring, and also an ability to overcome our own personal obstacles. That's what I hear on a regular basis from you guys, is stories of overcoming often very difficult situations and odds, and finding connection and friendship and inspiration and a willingness to try to make the world better despite that, and you inspire me all the time.
Hey.
Hi.
How are you?
Good. I met you last year for the first time in Vegas.
Yes.
And I absolutely loved you because my aunt has MS. And we had talked about it.
Yes.
And
thank you for sharing that. So
and my, this is my daughter's first time.
Welcome.
You were absolutely her favorite demon. Like
Meg.
And like there can never be another Meg. Like you are Meg. That's it. Period. Plain and simple. And your Clarence campaign inspired me so much that I actually have it tattooed on the side of my hand.
Are you serious?
Yeah, because it was my grandparents' favorite movie, because like they grew up in that age, you know, that era and stuff.
Yeah.
And I feel like you and Cass, I don't know, I do feel like you're still looking out for, you're his Clarence. Like, he may be your Clarence, but you're his Clarence, I think, according, at least for me. And I think you're such an inspiration, and I loved your whole Clarence campaign, and, you know, went crazy at the t-shirt.
A lot.
And I was like, the meaning behind your whole Clarence campaign really struck with me, and I was like, I've got to do it, you know?
Well, also, that be the change you wish to see in the world, or want to see in the world, is a Gandhi quote that has always inspired me.
Right.
Because I think it is one of the most important messages. It's just, rather than looking to the world, the outside world, or someone else, or whatever, to fix it, or we always have the chance to change things ourselves,
right,
and to be that.
Like, I feel like, because people are like, what is on your hand? And I put it on like the side of my hand so people see it and they're like, what is that? So then I'm like, you know what, listen here. If you want to see something change, then like do something.
Yes.
And I love Random Acts, and I love that you're a part of it. And we did Gishwiz last year and did the rap party,
yeah,
and saw you and I was like, yeah. We just love you, and just keep up doing what you're doing, because you're just such an inspiration to everyone.
Thank you for that. I have a question for you now.
Okay.
Actually, for your daughter. Are you having a good time at your first convention?
Yeah.
Nice. That's all that's important. Thanks.
She almost cried. She almost cried when Rob came out and was like, it's her first, she just turned 15, so it's like,
well, welcome. It's an amazing group of people. Have the best people.
Thank you for being such a good influence. animated persona.
Thank you.
You still kick ass. So.
Thank you so much. Seriously.
Hi. So I was wondering what the differences were on set between Sons of Anarchy, Californication, and Supernatural.
Very different on all of those sets. I'd say there's a magic on the Supernatural set. There's a camaraderie beyond anything that I've ever seen. Caring for each other and a lightness. Like, there's like this weird combination of complete professionalism but of levity, about everything. Not taking, I've never worked with anyone on the set that took themselves too seriously, which is huge. I'm very partial to that experience all around, and it's the entire crew, it's everyone. All three sets were lovely and filled with lovely people, so I don't want to undermine that at all. It's just to say, when you're around your family, you feel differently. There's a different level of love and comfort, and it's just factual. That's, just where I feel I fit. But I had an amazing experience, like on Sons. They were so nice, so cool. I got to work with Kim a lot, and he's just amazing. He's one of the kindest people. And it's so great because he plays such a evil character and crazy and whatever. And he's such a sweet, kind, caring man. I had a wonderful time doing that. I had a great time on Californication. It was a super fun character. It was a lot more nerve-wracking in that I was often doing very risky stuff, and having not seen it, I didn't know how it would come out, but in retrospect, so freaking funny. It was such an intelligent show. And I remember one of my favorite memories from that set was Pamela. Pamela and I became friends, and we also had like a weird We had weird sexy scenes together and things. But we'd be like talking, we'd be talking about that she was a mom and like looking for schools for her kids. So we'd literally like talking school systems and how to get your kid in, like whatever, all of that drama. And then it'd be like action. And we're like, oh yeah, sexy, sexy. Yeah, but it's very funny. It's good people.
Well, you were amazing in all of them. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning.
I should apologize if my words are a little jumbled. I'm really excited. This is my first con.
First of all, okay, never, never apologize. I'm sure I jumble words a lot, and I get very overly excitable. So you're in like company.
Okay, perfect. My question is, if Meg had the opportunity to be human on the show, whether she came back as a human or she got caught up in some crazy spell, what is something that you would want her to experience as a human rather than as a demon?
That's a really good question. So it's like the Meg demon personality, but getting to experience being human, the way cast it?
Yes.
Okay. I guess she's already experienced love to some degree. I think I like her to experience, I'd like her to experience caring about more people. I think she kind of got a taste for it in caring about Cass, but I think in general she was kind of one-track minded. In that, like, whether it was Lucifer, Yellow Eyes, or Cass, or whatever, she was tend to be very loyal to one other person, and that was what everything, all her energy was channeled into. I'd love her to experience community more, and kind of that feeling of caring and unity for groups of people. And I think that she never found that, and she hasn't got to kind of see the good in humans, even with their flaws. And I think that would be a really cool thing. What's your answer?
I don't know if it's necessarily an experience, but I'd want to see what kind of like human quirks she would have. Maybe if it was like fidgeting, or if she had like a favorite drink, or just like things that she would do on a normal Saturday if she got to sleep in and things like that.
I think that would be a lot of fun. I think she'd be like, she'd be a terrible cook and really impatient. Like, it'd be very funny to watch her have to learn these things. I have a question. Do angels and demons need to pee? It's a valid question. No?
Probably not.
So that would be a new one. It's something I always wonder, like, you know, with all our favorite action heroes and all these things, it's so great to watch someone just kicking butt, especially when they're on like some epic adventure and they're making it through all these trials, like an Indiana Jones or something. But I always wonder, like, in real life, it would be really frustrating, because like, how many times would you then have to figure out, you know, where you go pee in the jungle when you're running from the bad guys? And, like, I don't know, I think about these things. So yeah, that'd be a new annoyance. Mm-hmm. I obviously have a small bladder and have to think about these things.
Hi, there was an episode where Misha turned to human and he was so confused by digestion and going to the restroom. He's like, how do you guys do this?
That's good. Okay.
Yeah, it's a great episode. But I also wanted to thank you for all the random acts that gets me through the day and makes the world such a much better place. You're such an amazing actress. I'm an actress and you inspire me every day. I love your voice. I wish I had your voice. And my question, not to hold you up here, is what character in the whole world that you haven't played would you like to play?
Oh my goodness. First of all, thank you. And you guys are random acts, so it's an amazing thing to get to be a part of. And thank you for that. In terms of, I don't have a character offhand because of the fact that I love the joy of getting, like, I'm one of those, I don't want to see the Christmas present before I open it. Like, I don't want to know. I don't want to think about, like, I don't tend to fixate on what I don't have. I tend to enjoy whatever presents itself to me. That said, I know there were characters when I was younger that I really was fascinated by and wanted to play. I love strong women in history, so I always wanted to play Boadicea or Boudica. I also love Hypatia. So, what do you have something to say? Yeah, I'm definitely always been fascinated by just strong, intelligent women that maybe were marginalized, that we don't learn as much about historically. But yeah, I like to embody that strength, which I guess was one of the strange things with having a physical disability, to then find how you can still own that, because it's not connected to physical prowess, but that used to be where I got that kind of that rush, that feeling, was that feeling I could overcome physical odds, and now I can't always do that, but I still think what interests me is overcoming whatever life's odds and having that kind of integrity and strength regardless. Anyway, I guess what I'm saying is there's not a lot of, I'm waiting. I want more amazing female characters to exist. What about you?
I love historical characters. I was weird when I was a kid. I wanted to play like one of the six wives of Henry VIII or something like that. That's where I went. I went to all these crazy parks and stuff like that, like Anne Boleyn or whatever.
Beautiful.
But I just wanted to tell you again, amazing actress. And I actually had half my girl power shirt that you liked the last time I was in a picture with you.
Yeah.
And I forgot it. Next time, Denver. But anyway, love you.
You're amazing. And you're wearing that shirt regardless. You're wearing that message regardless. Yeah.
Hello.
Hi.
How's it going?
Thanks. I'm Valentina, and I want to ask you, what advice would you give to teams that have big dreams and aspirations?
Don't lose that sense of hope. Don't let the world dictate to you how to go about achieving your dreams. Remember that life is a creative activity, and we're all just trying to figure it out, so you can learn a lot from so many people and keep learning, but never mistake being able to learn for someone from someone for handing over responsibility to them, because ultimately you're the one who's going to be responsible for seeing those dreams to fruition, even if everyone thinks that's impossible. Or experts tell you you have to do X, Y, and Z. Make sure to always run it through your own logic and see if that's true, or see how maybe that's not true. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Thank you.
I wish you tons of luck with whatever you do, and just know that, yeah, you'll bring more and more understanding to it and learning, and never stop that process, but also never doubt the fact that you can achieve whatever you're aiming to achieve.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
So I started rewatching a little bit before the con just to get myself psyched up, and I went through all of your, like, those seasons that you were in, and you added just such, like, a levity and this fun side, like fun evil side to the show, and I particularly love your interactions with Misha as Cass. And I was wondering if you had any particular stories of you and Misha on set that just, like, were good memories or stories that you consider sharing with us.
That's awesome. I have lots of good Misha memories, but nothing that stands out is, like, it's going to be particularly interesting to anyone else. Mostly what you can probably figure is we're both really, we can both be real nerds. And so my favorite memories were, like, talking about books and things, the latest books that we've been reading, or, like, new psychological theories and things like, I don't know, just random stuff, or, you know, NPR podcasts, and I don't know, but it's really boring, but not to me. This is the stuff that does it for me. It's wonderful to talk to someone as smart and looking at, no, I don't mean as smart as me, I mean as smart as he is, and just look curious about the world and always trying to learn about it. That's my memory. Do you have anything? Do you have any fun Misha stories?
I don't, unfortunately. No, that's an awesome answer. Just, I don't know, it's really cool to, you know, we love you guys, and so it's cool to see, you know, the sides of you that we don't see on screen. So thank you so much.
Absolutely. I'm definitely, like, one of those, like, nerds through and through, which I think you guys probably don't have an illusion of anything else at this point. Yeah, that's what I can, like, just nerd out about a history lecture or something like that for a very long time.
Hey. Hi, Rachel. You always seem to be so kind and compassionate towards everyone and spend so much time trying to help others. How do you keep yourself from getting emotionally exhausted and overwhelmed by giving so much?
Thank you. That's an amazing, amazing question. What keeps me from being emotionally exhausted is doing that stuff. I don't feel depleted from anytime I'm connecting or able to help someone else, because there's so much energy that's generated in that connection. I definitely get my, I get my fuel in life off of purpose and a sense of accomplishment, or like that someone is walking away way better from, if they're walking way better from something, that will get me through anything. What I have to watch is any feeling of frustration or failure. So if I don't, if I like put a lot of energy into someone or something and I don't feel like I've succeeded in doing any good, that's when my energy depletes. So yeah, does that make sense?
Yes, it does. Thank you.
Yeah. So, but that's a matter of that you keep having to find new things. It's kind of mental games, new ways that you can make something useful, or you keep doing those activities where you do feel like you can kind of fulfill whatever that sense of purpose is.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. By the way, just on that note, I'm going to throw something out, which is, I think that's one of the hardest things this day and age, is that with everything that's going on in the world, whatever your politics are and all that, whatever is going on politically, there's often a feeling of powerlessness and a feeling that nothing that you're doing is making a difference. So it's super, super important to not only keep knowing that what you're doing is in fact making a difference, but also to find those things that give you that sense of accomplishment. And sometimes that they might seem small and you might write them off, but they can have a very profound big effect, because that's what's going to change the world. So even if it's just turning to your neighbor and having a nice exchange with them and making their day better, or you know, any of us online, like just keeping each other's hopes up and keeping each other going, so important right now. That's all.
For several years, I've been having mobility issues that are intermittent. And you know, the first time that I had to go to a store and use a scooter was really, really hard for me. And I want to know, how did you manage to get past that?
That's a really good question. I think the absolute most important thing is you're going to have to work on finding your self-worth without all these criteria that we often, and standards we often hold ourselves to. Because they're false, and they're actually, like, they don't really make a difference, but for some reason we think, like, if we're, I don't know, walking, or if we have makeup on, or if we, you know, whatever it is, hit some weight goal or whatever, then we're worthwhile. And we never actually, it doesn't actually handle anything. So you're gonna have to work on knowing you are awesome and can be a worthwhile and contributing member of the world in so many ways, whether you're in a scooter, whether you're in bed, whatever situation presents itself. It's not a failure, it's just a strategic difference. And if you're walking around holding on to some ideal or idea of what your life should look like, you're gonna be unhappy. But if you just enjoy what your life is like, there's so much joy to be found in everything. Does that make sense? And you guys taught me that. I hope you know that. Yeah, you just, because when I was gonna like not come to conventions anymore and things, because I was in the scooter, you said no, and got me to keep coming out and made me feel a part of this family still, and that means everything. So if I can give that back to you, that would make me very happy.
Say that I also have multiple sclerosis, so you're a huge inspiration, Mike. And my question is, at the end, toward the end of season 8, before your character died, obviously, Meg seemed to get more, you know, like, nicer and everything, and seemed to want to do more to help the boys and everything. Do you think that was more because of, like, her connection with all the boys, Sam, Cass, and Dean, or did it stem more from her connection with Castiel?
Okay, I'll answer it a second first, but also, you freaking rock, and know this, it's the weirdest illness in that you can't, it's very hard to predict, and it doesn't fit any mold, because it affects the nervous system, and the nervous system kind of does freaking everything. The biggest thing is don't get into trying to fight it, again, like, don't put unrealistic goals, just enjoy what you have. And know that, like, there's no, you don't hold anyone as an example in terms of, oh, I'll be using a scooter in the same time that took Rachel, because everyone's different.
Yeah.
You could go your entire life and never have to, so, I know you know all these things, but I just want to make sure. You rock. And then, in terms of that question, I think it was because she fell for Cass. What do you think?
Yeah.
That's what I think, too, because she had more of a connection with him, and Sam and Dean kind of hated her.
Yeah.
And like you said, didn't look for her when she was missing and being tortured by Crowley.
Yeah. No, but I don't know. She had a sweet spot, so to speak, for him. Like, something about him got through all her armor. And in a way that, like, Sam and Dean never had. Even when she was, like, in Sam's body, she didn't connect to him on the same level. So I think it was the different variable of having Cass around. So that's my theory.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, I'm an English teacher, so I'm always really curious, what is a book that's been really important to you in your life?
Oh my goodness, so many, but it's very hard for me to do without being there. Like, if you said, like, what is a history book, or what is a science book, or something, but I'll say, or philosophy, or something, like, there's so many brilliant books that have changed my life forever. One of the first ones that I remember, and I wrote a report on it, so it's easier, but one of the first ones that I remember really changing me, or impacting me, was Les Miserables. Something about the vision, I love things that have a broad scope. So I like the scope of time and the number of people and perspectives that were being covered, and the fact that across that time, their conditions changed so dramatically. And to me, that just, I guess that's the way my mind works, so it was one of the first times that I felt understood, is that that's perspective of us all being connected as human beings, and our conditions being very transient. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That was it. Was that a good, since you're a teacher, was that a decent man? What's my grade?
I'd give a solid A for that. Maybe okay. A bit more text evidence if we were in class, but okay. We're not, so. But I can hear my students being like, is there text evidence to support that?
Nice.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
I was thrilled that I can write text evidence to support my theories.
Yeah.
I never have text evidence. You want to take one more question?
Sure.
I have a question.
Okay, what's your question? I don't have text evidence.
What was your favorite episode of the episodes you did?
Of the episodes I did, probably the last one, Goodbye Stranger, because Robbie Thompson wrote that one.
So good.
It was so awesome.
All of those episodes are my favorites.
And my other favorite is your episode, Don't Call Me Shirley.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah. I was saying, but that
also
was
Robbie
so,
Thompson.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. It's so brilliant.
Awesome. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Rachel Moyer!